Meet the new Thirsty Head. Same as the old Thirsty Head. I mean, sorta. See, here's the deal. It's still me, Scott. Always has been. But a lot has changed since this URL first hit the web. Thirsty Head came to life in 2006, right around the release of my first book, J-Boss at Work. Of course, back then, Thirsty Head was called Davis World Consulting, Inc., perhaps the single most forgettable business name incorporated that year. It matched the single most forgettable haircut of the year. See, I had just rolled off two really meaty full-time gigs, working on a pre-release version of Google Maps in 2005 with Digital Globe, and writing an integrated open-source software installer in Groovy for a startup called OpenLogic. I was speaking at software conferences around the U.S. and around the world. I mean, at least 20 or 30 weekends a year with No Fluff, Just Stuff alone. I didn't realize it at the time, but 2006 was a major inflection point in my life. You see, up until then, I'd been a fairly traditional J2EE web developer for nearly a decade. I jumped into the Java stream at about the 1.1 headwaters. I am certain that the first version of Thirsty Head, davisworld.org, was deployed using that same tech stack, but I can't prove it. I've searched my personal backup for minutes, I tell you, just for a glimpse of that glorious code base, to no avail. So, you'll just have to take my word for it. It was a set of JSP pages, JSTL tags, and the occasional servlet talking to a PostgreSQL database. Up until 2006, my website had been just that, my website. I had a blog where I talked about my newborn kids, my cooking adventures, my friends, me. After 2006, I developed a state-sponsored split personality. ThirstyHead.com was no longer me. It was a brochureware website for this company that I founded. In effect, ThirstyHead became a client of mine, and it just didn't feel right talking about my kids on their corporate website. Flash forward a couple of years, and Thirsty Head is in full stride. I had already architected a new, fully FOSS mapping website for TriMet, the Portland, Oregon Transit Authority. They came to me and said, "We want Google Maps without the Google Maps." In other words, they wanted the Google Map experience, but on their servers, with their data, at their own URL. This was right in my wheelhouse, having written GIS for Web Developers, possibly my favorite book, and sadly, out of print. But GIS for Web Developers, as well as several other books and articles on the Google Maps API. I was traveling the world teaching classes and giving talks like roll your own Google Maps and adding where to your applications. I was also neck deep in the Groovy Grails ecosystem at this point, and ThirstyHead.com was solidly a Grails app. I had one of the first public-facing Grails-based websites back in the version 0.3 days, and kept up with each new dot release for years to follow. Now, Groovy Recipes, also out of print, do you see a pattern forming here? Groovy Recipes was the right book for the right time, allowing Java developers to get up to speed quickly in this new paradigm-shifting language that offered full source control and runtime compatibility with Java. My talks like Groovy the Blue Pill, writing next-generation Java code in Groovy, and Groovy the Red Pill, metaprogramming, the Groovy way to blow a button-down Java developer's mind, won me a couple of Java 1 Rockstar Awards, and I'm sure my hair at the time really had to help. See, I had a voice. I wrote several long-running article series for IBM Developer Works, including Practically Groovy and Mastering Grails. But I was no longer writing about myself and for myself. See, writing was work. Writing paid the bills. I was a professional author for some value of the word professional. Around that same time, the shiny new computer came out called the iPhone in 2007. I had already been writing websites for the mobile platform using WML, Wireless Markup Language, and WAP, Wireless Application Protocol. I was doing Palm Pilot development using J2ME, fun stuff like capturing signatures as SVG, uploading them to Java servlets, and then using Apache Batik to convert them to JPEGs for web consumption. But the iPhone was a different beast entirely. It had a proper web browser, and it did what no other cell phone at the time was able to do. It reunified the web into a single platform, killing off the separate but equal m.dot websites with little regret. See, the web on the iPhone was the proper web, albeit with an entirely new UX paradigm comprised of fingers and pinches and swipes. And I dove in head first. When the App Store came around with the iPhone 2.0, and remember, HTML was the officially sanctioned way to do iPhone development up until then, I had no interest in catering to a single platform solution like Objective-C. I had been dipped in right once, run anywhere for too long to heed the siren's call of a one-trick pony, however attractive that pony was. This led to the next phase of ThirstyHead. 2011 started the modern era of ThirstyHead. I co-founded the HTML5 Denver user group that year. I was slinging HTML5 on smartphones and tablets, desktops and laptops, even smart TVs. I headed up a team that designed and implemented the Samsung smart TV interface for a major cable company, written entirely in HTML5. For another project, we wrote a mobile web app for the Colorado Department of Transportation that helped disseminate information about ongoing construction projects. You know, lane changes, exit closures, and a traffic thermometer that included live camera views at key intersections atop a Google map. 2011 was the year that smartphones first outsold laptops. We're now living in an era where mobile internet usage surpasses legacy desktop usage, and that tiny handheld 4-inch slab of glass is, in many ways, a person's sole portal into the World Wide Web. At this point, the ThirstyHead.com website was a Node.js app with copious amounts of Twitter bootstrap sprinkled over it for that extra tasty, responsive web design goodness. It was around this time that I started feeling a vague, general malaise about web development, but I couldn't quite put my finger on it. You know, not about the information superhighway itself, but more so the vehicles that we were building to hit that on-ramp. I learned Backbone.js and Bootstrap, jQuery Mobile, Angular.js. None of these are bad projects. I really genuinely enjoyed my time working with each one of them. Many of the gigs I was being brought in on to tackle at the time were more than simple, can you help us make our website more mobile-friendly type projects? They were, according to the client, full-on rescue projects. We've had developers working on this for over 2 years and we haven't shipped a single release yet. One manager said, we've been doing Flash and Flex development for almost a decade. I have no idea why my team can't get up to speed with mobile HTML5 techniques after just a day or two of classroom training. I gently explained to him that while Flash apps are technically run inside the browser, the Flash development process has almost nothing to do with core platform web development. See, his developers had no understanding of HTML or CSS or JavaScript because they simply hadn't been using it for almost a decade. To add insult to injury, any meager platform experience that his team did have was hopelessly out of date. By, you said it, at least a decade. See, they were experts in Flash, but a Flash app is like flying a UFO into the browser. You rarely interact with the natives, and when you do, it's with pity and contempt through the jaundiced eyes of an advanced civilization. And believe me, at this point, I was quite familiar with the contemptuous attitude that most real developers had towards this toy programming language called JavaScript. I mean, don't forget, I spent the first 10 years of my programming career as a Java developer. That kind of patronizing attitude was almost required of us. Jeering at the diminutive junior namesake of a real language wasn't simply being petty or provincial. It was baked into the official history and narrative of JavaScript from the start. No less an authority than Brendan Eich, the creator of JavaScript, characterized JavaScript as a language for hobbyists, a stepping stone towards the more advanced, real language capabilities of Java. Sibling rivalry is rarely the foundation of thoughtful, nuanced discussions, especially when people aren't willing to acknowledge the familial history in the first place. It's a revelation to many of the seasoned Java developers I meet that Java and JavaScript were introduced to the public on the same day in the same place. Little web browser called Netscape Navigator 2.0. See, client-side applets were supposed to be the future of Java, but server-side servlets are where Java actually rode to prominence. Perhaps this is the root of the pervasive sour grapes attitude common among many Java developers. Server side is where all of the civilized action takes place. The web browser, on the other hand, is this Mad Max-esque, post-apocalyptic, lawless desert wasteland. See, even I'm willing to admit that in the earliest days of JavaScript, perhaps those grapes were a bit tart now that you mention it, but they were not nearly as inedible as contemporaneous Java developers would have you believe. And in the case that these nostalgic memories of yours cloud your memories, allow me to remind you that Java was differently, yet similarly immature as JavaScript was back in those primordial 1.0 days. It's folly to think that 20 plus years of active development has added sophistication to one of the languages and left the other in its 1996 infant state. It amazes me that even today, the web platform is often characterized as impoverished or in disjoint, and that UIs are better off generated from another more powerful language than being natively written. No company would dream of hiring a Java developer without Java experience, or a C-sharp developer without C-sharp experience, or a Ruby developer without Ruby experience. You get the idea. And yet, back-end web developers, air quotes, intentional, these back-end web developers who've never had any formal training in core web platform technologies are commonplace. See, when the development team struggles to produce a viable web app, the culprit is almost always assumed to be the current framework in use. And the solution is almost always finding another, newer, more improved framework. Improving the team's impoverished and disjoint core platform language skills is rarely considered when adding and, yeah, learning yet another abstraction layer. Now that layer can mask the symptoms for a little while longer instead of actually curing the disease. So what does all this have to do with the shiny new ThirstyHead.com in front of us, Mr. Ranty McRancelot? Okay, last year, I started a new project using a pre-release version of Angular 2. The early learning curve was quite steep, especially quite steep for a team of experienced Angular 1 developers. Now, I initially chalked our struggles up to new platform metaphors like ESX classes and web components and reactive streams. But even after we internalized these new concepts, of course by learning them outside of the framework, Angular 2 felt more like an opaque abstraction layer than syntactic sugar. And don't even get me started on the tooling requirements of Angular 2. Angular 1's Hello World started with, add this script tag to import the Angular library, and you had your first example up and running in literally seconds. Angular 2's Hello World, on the other hand, was a 10 to 15 minute Byzantine multi-step, multi-file process that required build scripts and module loaders and an especially fragile collection of import order specific library dependencies, many of which were Angular specific forks of independent projects. I spent more time writing yeoman scripts to automate the complexity away than writing application features. I invested heavily in writing custom gulp scripts, hoping to encapsulate and insulate the team from the high ceremony of the framework. Instead, I ended up spreading on yet another layer of abstraction that ultimately hindered our understanding of the framework instead of enhancing it. We avoided using TypeScript from the very beginning, largely because I was concerned about the potential drag on our project's velocity as a result of bringing in third-party dependencies that didn't have the associated but non-optional TypeScript artifacts. Now, as it turns out, even bringing in plain old JavaScript libraries was unexpectedly, punishingly difficult. Few of the libraries utilized ESX modules, so we were faced with the unsavory choice of either metaphor shear, this one is global, this one must be imported, or fiddly retrofitting of old stable libraries to satisfy our new module loader's demands. So, after 9 months of development, we actually scuttled the code base and completely started over. We had already been successfully using Polymer and Material Design for basic UI components like tabs and dialog boxes and form fields, so why not just go ahead and use it for the entire app? The team enjoyed the dramatically simplified development process, and the look and feel far surpassed anything that we would have been able to come up with on our own. Now, management was initially concerned that we were chasing yet another shiny new framework. We weren't, of course. Polymer was stable at 1.6, and there was a 2.0 release right around the corner. I reassured them that the core ideas that we learned for Angular 2, things like ESX classes and web components, these same things were at play here in Polymer as well, so the switch was actually more of a mild syntax change than a deep semantic change of direction. So, what does all this have to do with the new ThirstyHead.com, Sir Rancelot? Lick. I like Polymer. I really do. Hashtag use the platform, yo! But as I started to build out the new ThirstyHead.com in it, I finally came to grips with the general malaise that I'd been feeling all of these years. For all of the hundreds, if not thousands, of development hours that I've invested in ThirstyHead.com over the years, I have absolutely nothing to show for it. And here I was, about to do it all over again. See, I have full code bases in Java, in Groovy, in JavaScript, and yet I have no foundation to speak of to build this latest versions of my website. See, my content is all tied up in legacy databases that I no longer want to support, and my exoskeleton is implemented in artifacts that aren't reusable across languages and servers, you know, JSPs, GSPs, that sort of thing. So once again, I'm pursuing the Dell *** upgrade method, which in my case is technically rm-rfsplat, but, you know, a rose by any other name. This speaks to a deeper, more uncomfortable issue. See, I don't get paid by this customer, ThirstyHead, to develop their website. In fact, I'm paying my customer with precious personal hours that could be otherwise spent with my wife or my kids or my guitar or my oven or my grill. So I am highly, highly motivated to minimize the cost and time spent on this project. And what have I historically invested my limited development budget in? Languages and frameworks instead of content, scaffolding instead of substance, ephemera masquerading as foundation, UFOs. Meanwhile, the very first website ever written by Tim Berners-Lee is available and readable today from any browser on the planet, even, especially, from browsers and platforms that didn't exist until decades long after the page was originally written. So, apparently, this is my cue to give some lofty, full-throated manifesto. After all this buildup, I'm afraid it might end up being a tad underwhelming. Are you ready? Here goes. I'm going to write this website in HTML and CSS and JavaScript. Not dramatic enough? Okay. I'm only going to use my own handwritten HTML, CSS, and JavaScript, huh? Yeah, no third-party libraries, no frameworks, no UFOs. What, still not enough? Okay, how about a call to action then? I think that you should too. Not everywhere, but somewhere. At least once. Because at the end of the day, this is what web development is. HTML. CSS, JavaScript. Don't allow anyone to convince you otherwise. Don't get fooled again. Now, your first attempt may look janky and warty and nothing at all like Bootstrap or Material Design or WordPress or Medium. Look, that's okay. If it bothers you enough, it won't stay that way for long. And, oh, by the way, thanks for waiting a respectful amount of time before agreeing with the janky and warty parts as you gaze upon my first attempt. See, I limited myself to only HTML and CSS for this first pass. Not a lick of JavaScript to be seen, and to be honest, it made me more uncomfortable than I care to admit. I copy and pasted chunks of text around that would be better served by web templates. I have a ton of duplication that is just crying out for templates and pagination. But for this first pass, I wanted to feel that pain, and I wanted to feel it personally because I wanted to understand what was needed to build up instead of fearfully relying on a Yagni-laden library all full of someone else's pain relief. So, what you're witnessing here is a minimum viable website. And interestingly, back in 1995, yeah, they're just called websites. Yeah, Now, in the spirit of full disclosure, I wrote the long-form prose of this page using ASCII Doctor, but really only to automate the mundane paragraph and H1 insertions, tags, and things like that. Everything else you see at ThirstyHead.com was lovingly handcrafted by this guy. So, this really isn't a screed against web frameworks or programming languages other than JavaScript. I am absolutely going to continue to use them professionally, write about them, and talk about them at a software conference near you. But what you read here at ThirstyHead.com from now on will be unapologetically my voice once again. And what you see will be unapologetically my source code. GitHub, along with GitHub Pages, is a completely free place for you to host your website. You can see the raw source for this website at github.com/thirstyhead/thirstyhead.github.io. Look for it, you'll find it. And if you don't like GitHub, there are many other sites out there that offer similar functionality. #bespoke HTML, your move.